Is liberty dying where you live? Escape to Keene at freekeene.com.
Thank you. Have a seat, please. Deputy Thompson.
Well, that was correct. My family name is Angell.
That's how it's pronounced?
Right.
All right. We have a series of motions that were just filed.
Yeah, I just got them, Your Honor. I reviewed it with Sergeant Bro. We feel that the information that he's looking for can come out in trial and want to go forward.
Okay. All right, the procedure is that, actually, first we'll take up the motions, I guess. You have copies of what you filed there?
Yes, I do.
You have a copy of the complaint that was filed against you?
I believe I do.
Yeah, I just want to make sure you have, we'll make you a copy if you don't.
He may have to plead not. Well, actually, it was a month ago. Because he may have sent it in, plead not guilty. Well, being a must appear, he was handed that.
Right. Get a copy of that so that the defendant can. I will make you a copy of it. Just make sure you have it.
I need a bailiff in the court.
All right, it's a rule of court to stand when you address the court. So you'll have to stand up when you address the court.
Never mind, Larry's doing.
There's a motion to suppress here. I'll let you argue that first. Your motion. Actually, in reading it, it looks like some of the, I may reserve judgment until I hear how the facts develop, because that may determine what the ruling is, now that I've taken a careful look at it. Right? On the next motion is motion in limine on the issue of a way. You can argue that.
Well, my legal counsel has advised that these need to be addressed before we actually go with the trial.
The motion to suppress, sometimes we can deal with them ahead of trial, sometimes they're determined by the facts as they come out through trial. But very often the court just reserves judgment until we get to that point to see whether or not it should be granted or not. So on the motion to suppress, I'm going to wait until I hear how the evidence develops up to that particular point. Mm-hmm. And then I'll make a ruling. On the motion to exclude evidence of a way, the motion in limine that you filed, that one we can argue right now if you want. But it's your motion. You need to tell me what you think I should rule on that and why.
Well, it says,
one it says defendant's motion in limine to exclude evidence of a way is defined by RSA 259:125.
Right.
It's the one where you say they have to have formal evidence of any street or highway that's going to be mentioned in the case.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, it's all written out here, so I'm not sure what.
Well, if you just want to rest on what you pled, that's okay too. But if you wanted to argue it, you know, orally here, that I'd give you that opportunity. If you don't think you need to, that's fine.
Yeah, I don't know that I have anything to add.
Okay, all right. What's your position on that?
Well, Your Honor,
you can have a seat while he's talking if you want.
The violation took place in the center of Keene, in the common out here, Main Street, Roxbury Street. It's a common, well-known public area. Public access, public way.
I guess, what's your position? He made a formal demand, however.
Yes, Your Honor, I did see that afterward. We provided him all the discovery that we had. Also, in my response to him, in the discovery letter, I do indicate if I have omitted any documents that you've asked for or request any further, please contact me. I haven't received any information from him saying that I had omitted the that proper document.
All right. Based on the facts of the case, which seem to have been contained in the pleadings, the court takes mandatory judicial notice that Roxbury Street and Main Street are ways. That's pursuant to State versus Barkas. So I'll deny the motion on a formal way. Now you have a general demur and motion to dismiss for vagueness. What's your argument on that one?
Well,
as far as I know, I don't have anything to add to that either.
Okay. Did someone else prepare these for you?
Yes, that's correct.
An attorney?
My legal counsel.
But not a licensed attorney?
Right.
Okay. All right. Anything to say about that?
Your Honor, I believe the statute's clear that if you operate on a way in the state of New Hampshire, it will need a license to run.
The terms that are in dispute here, according to what to the defendant's pleading, are valid driver's license. That phrase, court feels that it can accord words like that to their ordinary and usual meanings, and there's nothing vague about it, at least constitutionally vague about it, that would support dismissal. So the motion is denied. So the motion to suppress will be taken up during the course of the case. The procedural, how many witnesses did the prosecutor have? Yes.
There was a third.
It's the motion to suppress that I was talking about. Is there another one besides that?
Well, when we talk about the motion of the vagueness.
Yeah. You mean the appropriate class or type of license?
Right.
I don't know that's even an issue in this case.
Okay, well.
And that's not even an issue here. The issue isn't whether you had a particular correct class or type of license, at least as far as I can see. But is that an issue here? Like whether you had a commercial license or a motorcycle license or something like that?
Right. There's no indication of which license I'm supposedly required to have.
Right. I think based on what you filed here, you're operating a passenger vehicle?
Well.
I'm looking at what you filed.
Right.
I'm not looking at anything else but the document you provided the court.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, to the best of my belief and knowledge, I am traveling.
Pardon me?
I am traveling in an automobile operating a vehicle or a passenger vehicle. That sounds like legal terminology that I'm incapable of addressing.
Well, it has a legal import, I guess, based on the context of the case. I would agree with you to that extent, but to the extent that there's anything vague about what you're charged with here, I can't agree with you on that issue. Any of these motions that I've denied, if you are unsuccessful in your main case today, you can appeal to the state Supreme Court.
Uh-huh.
And that's usually where ultimately the constitutionality of the statute is adjudicated. Okay. So you know, just because I'm ruling against you doesn't mean that you can that you can't appeal those decisions. Okay? All right. And so we're still left with the motion to suppress them, which will have to hear how the evidence comes in. Alright, you can have a seat, please. All right, just to persist, go over the procedure. You have one witness?
That's correct.
Okay, and the witness will come to the stand, be sworn in, and give testimony. When the witness is done with the testimony, if you have questions to ask about the case, you can ask those questions at that time. If you have You're not obligated to ask any questions. If you don't want to ask questions, it's up to you. But that'll be your only chance to ask that witness any questions about your case. When the state rests this case, it'll be your opportunity. If you want to put on evidence related to the case, you can do that. Do you have any witnesses that you plan to be calling?
Not today.
Okay. Well, today is the day.
Okay.
And if you want to testify, you can. You're not obligated to testify. No one can force you to testify. The prosecutor has the burden of proving the case beyond a reasonable doubt. You don't have to say or do anything if you don't want to.
Mm-hmm.
Right. If I can make the decision once I've heard it here, I'll let you know what it is. Is your mail address still General Delivery, Missoula, Montana?
Well, that's actually rather obsolete.
Well, the reason I need addresses sometimes so that if we make decisions or there are orders that come out with respect to the case, the only address we have is the address that you give us. If we don't have a better address than that and something happens and you don't show up in court and bench warrant issues, that won't be the court's fault, it won't be the police's fault, it'll be your fault.
Well,
that's why we need to have good addresses for people.
Well, I can be reached at the address that's found on these motions.
Okay.
It's in West London.
We needed to mail you, if I needed to, for example, to visit the scene or take some time to think about your case and I was going to mail you the decision, what's the best way to mail that to you to make sure you got it?
The West Lebanon address that's found on the motions.
Well, questions about how the procedure will work here today?
No.
Okay. You can have a seat.
State calls Sergeant Daniel Bro.
I want to apologize in advance. I may have to take a phone call on a family matter. I don't know if or when it's going to come in, but if it comes in, I have to take it. I have to take a quick recess. Please raise your hand. So I'm a square affirm that anything you say here will be the truth.
So help me God.
Have a seat, please.
Could you state your name, spell your last name, please?
Daniel Richard Brough, B-R-O-W.
And how are you so employed?
By the Division of State Police.
And how long have you been employed?
Since April 2nd, 1999.
And in telecourt, if any, what rank you hold with the state police?
I'm a uniform sergeant.
And how long have you been a sergeant?
Since July 30th, 2010.
Drawing your attention, Sergeant, to January 5th of this year, can you tell the court what you were doing and how you were assigned?
Yes, I was working my assigned patrol shift in uniform on that particular evening. I happened to be in the city of Keene, traveling north on Main Street.
Okay. Can you tell the court whereabouts on Main Street you were?
I was approximately 75 yards south of Central Square. I was northbound on Main Street, approaching Central Square.
At approximately 1 o'clock in the morning, can you tell the court, if any, what you observed?
At that time, as stated, I was traveling north on Main Street, approximately 75 yards south of Central Square, intending to continue through Central Square, that intersection. Facing me were green traffic lights. Those traffic lights were allowing me to proceed through Central Square in my direction of travel. However, as I was approaching the green lights, intending to proceed through, I observed a Ford Bronco 2 off to my left, or to the left of the intersection or Central Square. That vehicle proceeded across my path of travel around or across Central Square and continued onto Roxbury Street.
Now, from your observation, can you tell the court where that vehicle came from?
The direction I was traveling, north, it would have been off to my left, so the vehicle was coming from the the side of Central Square that is adjacent to the row of businesses, including Vendetta, Pedraza's, the entrance to the New Hampshire Public Defender's Office, Anthony Topper Jewelers.
So this vehicle would be off to your left?
Yes.
In the rotary?
Yes, Central Square is a large rotary. The vehicle was coming from that side of the rotary.
Now, are you familiar with this area?
Very well.
Okay. From where that vehicle was, can you tell me how many lanes were over there?
There are three lanes for traffic, two lanes for traffic that are looking to proceed south on Main Street. One lane goes off to the right for traffic traveling on West Street. There is one other lane. If you're driving a vehicle and you get as far left as you can, if you're coming south around the rotary, if you get over to the left as far as you can, there is another lane that will start that allows a vehicle to proceed around Central Square to continue back north. Approaching that lane before it becomes a lane, it's rather narrow. However, there are those other lanes, like I said, permitting or designed for traffic traveling south on Main Street, the left of which is also designed for vehicles that are intending to proceed around Central Square and continue over onto Roxbury Street.
So there's not a specific lane designated for the Roxbury Street turn?
The lane that it is used is that left lane. There's two lanes to go south on Main Street. The lane that is used is the left or inside lane.
Is there a light that controls this particular lane?
Yes, there is.
Now, Trooper, in your experience, if your light is green to go through the intersection, is the light for to turn onto Roxbury Street red or green?
It is red.
Is it designated by an arrow or a solid circle?
I believe it's a red arrow. There are arrows there permitting traffic south on Main Street and also for the traffic that intends to proceed onto Roxbury Street.
Now, did you observe anything unusual as you approached the intersection?
As I was approaching the intersection, as stated, I observed this Ford Bronco 2 off to my left. My lights were green, allowing me to continue through the intersection. The Bronco came to my left, to my right, passed into my path of travel quite clearly in disregard of the red traffic signal that would have been facing it, and continued on to Roxbury Street.
Did you have occasion to stop that vehicle?
I did. I made a right turn into Roxbury Street, stopped the vehicle in the area of the parking lot for Abishon Hardware.
Your Honor, at this time, the state would ask the court to take judicial notice that Main Street and Roxbury Street in the city of Keene are public works.
Consistent with the court's earlier ruling, the court feels actually that judicial notice is mandatory in a case like this. And, Roxbury Street and Main Street are considered ways.
Thank you, Your Honor. Now, Trooper, did you have make contact with the driver of that vehicle?
Yes, I did.
Is the driver of that vehicle present in the courtroom today?
Yes, he is. He's seated to your left at the table.
Your Honor, the state would ask that the record to reflect that Sergeant Breaux has pointed out to the defense. The
court will take such notice.
Thank you. Trooper, can you tell me what kind of conversation you had with the defendant?
Pleasant. I found the driver, Mr. Angell, to be a gentleman. I advised him why I stopped him for the traffic signal violation. Based upon the license plates that were on his vehicle there in Montana, I assumed that he was not from the area, possibly not been living here very long. Asked him about that. He confirmed that he hadn't lived in the area very long. We discussed the traffic lights, his violation. I admitted to him that the lights there can be very confusing. particularly to those new to the area. After that, I asked him for his license, driver's license, and registration for the vehicle. He did ask if he was required to present those documents. I told him that he was. He gave no argument to that. He presented a valid registration for the vehicle, and then presented what I believe was a driver's proficiency certificate.
Right. At this point, the issue on the motion to suppress is, this is where your motion to suppress kicks in.
Uh-huh.
Okay, why don't we just kind of pause, and do you want to argue that motion at this point based on the evidence? I assume the rest of the evidence is about the license issue?
That's correct.
Right. Do you want to address the motion to suppress now?
Well, you all have to understand, this is my first trial. I'm really not a violent person. But I thought we already discussed that before we got started, so I don't know if there's anything else to...
Well, no, the motion to suppress is the first one. Remember, I said we would take that up. The ruling would depend on the facts as they develop. And now I think all the facts that the court would need to hear to make a decision and to testify to. From this point forward, I think the testimony is based on the license issue and not on the motion to suppress question. So
I
want to give you the chance to argue your motion to suppress now.
Right. Well, the way I see it, if the lights are confusing and people are misreading them all the time, that tells me that there's an issue with the city of Keene and the town square, and that if people are getting...
Well, you have to argue on the evidence here.
Uh-huh.
The only evidence I have is what was testified to, so you have to limit it to what your argument is.
Well,
I take it you're saying because you don't think that the witness, I understand your motion, right? Because the witness does not have a vantage point to actually see the light from the direction you traveled.
Well, yeah, that's what it is.
That he shouldn't have stopped you. Is that basically what you're arguing?
Right.
Anything else on top of that you wanted to argue?
No, I can't think of anything at this time.
Do you mind if I ask the witness a question?
Okay.
In my experience, that sometimes at late hours, the lights on Central Square switch to flashing. In other words, they're flashing green usually for Main Street and coming out of and flashing red or yellow for the cross traffic. So what was the status of the lights that night?
They were not flashing. They were functioning normally.
Did you want to ask, based on the question I asked, did you want to ask him a question now?
This isn't
your main tech. This is sort of like an interruption of the trial, so this isn't your full cross-examination of him. But if you want to ask him a question based on what I asked him about the status of the lights, they were flashing or not, you can ask him that.
Okay, well,
You don't have to, I just wanted to give you the opportunity.
Uh-huh. Well, I guess the question that hasn't been addressed is whether you could see green lights, the same green lights or not lights that I could see.
No, the only green lights that I could see were the ones facing me, allowing me to go through the intersection.
Okay. That's about it.
Do you have any questions based on the question I asked him about the status of the lights?
No, you don't.
Okay. All right. You can have a seat then. Testimony is such that the witness, with his experience, has a good reason to feel that the light was red in the direction you were traveling. That's not what you're charged with in any event, so he had reason to stop you. And so the motion to suppress is denied. All right, you can continue now.
So, Trooper Refresh, what type of documents did the defendant provide you to stop?
He showed a valid vehicle registration for the vehicle he was driving, and like I said, what I believe was called a driver's proficiency certificate issued by the Republic of Panama.
Do you recall what state the registration was from?
Montana.
And the vehicle was properly registered in that state?
Yes, it was.
Did you inquire from the driver how long?
I want that fellow to take his hat off. It's disrespectful to the court.
Sir, would you remove your hat, please?
May I ask why it's disrespectful?
You're supposed to keep consistent with the dignity of the proceedings. You can sit outside if you want to, but you're not going to wear the hat in here.
I'm just wondering how it's disrespectful.
Because it's disrespectful to wear a hat indoors in a proceeding such as this. Step outside and take the hat off. You're welcome to stay if you take your hat off. I'm going to take a recess. If I come out and you're still out here with the hat on, it'll be consent. That's all.
All right.
When he comes back, he said.
Define disrespect.
That's what I was looking for, the definition of disrespect.
Yeah. Now, there was a disrespectful consideration.
Jews, for example,
Your response is to turn up the arrest. Without harming him. That's what the deal is.
There you go.
Sir, it was not an issue until you made it an issue.
Deep behind you. Mr.
What's the matter with you guys, huh?
You gotta turn around, Dean.
I will.
Could just leave people alone, you know.
That's true.
Okay. What do you plan on doing?
Okay, what we're going to do is you're going to pick up on the side. We're going to set him up.
We're going to turn it, rotate it around.
Okay.
Thanks for protecting us from the hat wearers.
I was terrified.
Okay. Yeah, that'll be nice.
Protect and serve.
I see people.
Yeah. Okay.
You ever considered honest employment? You ever considered like a real job? One where you don't use violence against people? And it's like,
perhaps.
I hear Walmart is hiring.
I mean, the judge did not even define disrespect to the court. He said it's just disrespect to the court.
You should be ashamed of yourself with disrespect to the court. You can't
be up
here. Can't be up here.
This is a secure area. Back there is a secure area. Yeah, I'm going to take a small pull. Okay.
Sorry,
you guys
feeling
against
violence against
peaceful people. 5,000-year-old golden rule, do not do to others as you would not have done to yourself.
I'll be out of your way. I'm
not in the picture of the prosecutor.
I didn't know you were going to take my paycheck.
Thank you. Have a seat, please. registration was from 110.
Thank you, Your Honor. All right, Trooper, did he provide you any license to drive?
No, just the certificate I spoke of.
Did you inquire from him if he had a license to drive?
I did. We discussed the certificate. He told me that was the only document that he had along those lines. He did mention that business he worked for would cause him to travel to Panama on occasion. I asked him if he ever had a license issued by any of the states. He stated that he had not.
What did you do then?
I returned to my cruiser, asked my dispatcher to conduct a license search to see if Mr. Angell did in fact have a license or ever had a license.
And what was the outcome of that?
I was determined that he had been a licensed driver in the state of Montana. However, his driver's license had expired in 2006.
Then what did you do? Sorry.
I wrote a summons for operating without a valid license, returned to Mr. Angell's car, explained that to him, and also explained that I wasn't writing the summons for the traffic light violation. He offered no argument, again, as a gentleman. And at my advice, he actually had a friend drive the vehicle away.
Did Mr. Angell ever say where he was staying or resided?
Not that I recall.
Did this end your conversation with the defendant?
It did.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Okay, before I turn it over to you, Mr. Angell, Jason Talley, who's Jason Talley? Okay, I granted your motion to record, but I just noticed on your motion, it doesn't say what says your address is 31. I can't make out the rest of the address.
31 Hoyt Road, Free Grafton in the Shire.
What town do you live in?
Free Grafton in the Shire.
In Grafton, New Hampshire? You want to continue to record, or don't you?
Oh, I'd like to record
this
trial.
Well, then you tell me what town you reside in.
It's Free Grafton. It's in the Shire.
In Grafton, New Hampshire? Would other people recognize it as Grafton, New Hampshire?
Other people live in Grafton, New Hampshire.
Right. Not going to record unless you cooperate.
I'm sorry, what do you need from me?
Your address?
I think the mailing address is Grafton, New Hampshire.
Okay, that's all I'm asking you.
Right. There you go.
Did you read the rules with respect to the operation of the camera equipment in the courtroom?
I've been here before filming.
That's not my question. My question is, have you read the rules?
No, I haven't today.
Okay. All right. Well, just you're obligated to know what they are. Just letting you know that. Okay. Mr. Angell, do you have any questions you want to ask the witness here?
Well,
I do have one question. Will I be questioning? Will I be questioning the prosecutor as well as the witness?
You can call the witness if you want, but I guess the question would be what the relevance would be of the testimony.
Well, I just noticed that everybody here in this room seems to be representing the state, and I'm here all by myself. I feel like I'm outnumbered.
Well, I'd have a different point of view.
Mm-hmm. What is it?
You only have to ask this witness questions, but the case hasn't been turned over to you for your defense yet. We do this in progression here. If you have any questions for the witness, you can ask those questions now. If you want to put on a defense, we'll get to that after we get through the first part of the case.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have any questions for the witness, once again, as I said before, you don't have to ask him any questions
right.
If you don't want to.
Okay. Well, at this point, I don't.
Well, this is the only chance you're pretty much going to get.
Okay, well, I don't have any.
Okay, all right, you can have a seat. Anything else?
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Okay, this is where we turn it over to you. If you want to put on a defense, do you have a witness to testify?
Well, no, I don't.
Okay, but did you want to testify?
You mean like testify on the stand or just make a statement?
Well, if you want me to consider any facts that I haven't already heard from sworn testimony, they have to come from sworn testimony, mm-hmm. all right, or admissible evidence. Okay. So if you want to, you'll be able to make an argument later on about the evidence, but if you want me to consider any new facts that I haven't already heard, it has to come from somebody. It doesn't have to be you, but it has to be from somebody.
Yeah. Okay. So...
If you don't have any facts to add, that's fine. But, uh-huh. sometimes what people do when they're representing themselves is they argue, and then they throw in facts that I haven't already heard.
Right.
Because you have to be subject to cross-examination just like that witness was.
Sure.
If you don't take the stand, you lose. There's no other evidence.
Well, actually, I'm not interested in taking the stand.
Okay, that's all right. All right, so that basically you rest your case on what I've heard so far?
Right.
Okay, now if you wanted to make a legal argument about, or an argument about what the evidence means and what I should do, you can do that.
Okay, so that's the time that I do that right now?
Yes.
Okay. Well, the reason I'm here is because apparently there's been some kind of contract that's been made without my input. The state of New Hampshire, which is a corporation, seems to have this idea that in order for me to travel, I have to carry a license or permission from the state to do that. And I cannot tell a lie. The reason I don't have a driver's license, because as a matter of conscience, I can't get one because I cannot ask permission from the government to exercise my right to travel on roads that are supposedly public roads. I do so in a safe, reasonable, and prudent manner. The record from the Department of Motor Vehicles in Montana shows that there's no conviction or accident on file. So I'm not out harming, endangering other people. I'm just a peaceful person traveling about, minding my own business. And I wouldn't be here if it weren't for a questionable light system that seems to trap a lot of people. And it's only fair to tell you that as one standing on principle, I have no intention of paying any fine. So if there be any conviction, well, it's outside of my control what will happen. But if I go to jail, I go to jail. I rest on my right to travel. And my rights come from my creator, not from the state, not from any police officer, prosecutor, or judge, or anybody else representing any corporate entity or government. And nothing that can be said or done in this court can change that. The contrary.
Anything else?
Well, it is my intent to continue to travel in a safe, reasonable, and prudent manner. And that is it.
Thank you.
Nothing.
Argument's well spoken. Your testimony was that you were a gentleman on the scene. The court has no reason to believe otherwise. Your argument is really not for a court, however. Your argument is with the legislature. If you don't think the law is valid, you need to get them to change it. The case has been proven beyond reasonable doubt, and my obligation is to enter a guilty finding. What's the recommendation for a disposition?
It's a standard $103.33.
Now, I'll give you another opportunity if you want. If you if you're telling me that you simply refuse to pay the fine, you're going to put me in a difficult position here. If you're saying that you just aren't going to pay the fine, I'll have to do some. I'll have to give you time in jail.
Well, how about an appeal?
Well, if you appeal it, then you don't have to go to jail until the appeal is heard.
Well, that's what I want to do then. Okay. Is appeal the case.
All right, we'll give you the information out there, but I guess the question is, well, the disposition, we'll wait until the appeal runs out, okay? And then you can readdress the issue of whether the fine is going to be $103.33. Letting you know on the record, you need to keep the court advised at all times of your address where you can get mail, because if the appeal is heard, if it's decided in your favor, the case is over. If it's not decided in your favor, then you'll come back and it'll be a disposition here. If you don't perfect your appeal and follow through with it, then the court will schedule a hearing to impose the sentence. At that point, you can decide whether you want to pay it or deal with it some other way. Right? So they'll give you the information. I'm going to note your appeal on here. Need to get your paperwork outside in the lobby before you go, and they'll tell you what you need to do.
Very well.
Any questions?
No.
Okay. No, so just wait in the lobby for your paperwork there. Tell them that you had a decision and it was not in your favor and you want to appeal to the Supreme Court, and they'll give you what you need.
Very well.
Alexander Olson.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.